the Linux world of today isn't like that of the 90s. Nowadays, you have tons and tons and tons of corporate interest. And whether or not that's a good thing, that's the way it is. From AMD to Meta, even Microsoft, who traditionally absolutely despised Linux and tried to crush the project. If you don't think that's the case, go read up on your history, go read the Halloween document, and, you know, try to bring that into the zeitgeist that a lot of people seem to have completely forgotten. And of course, there are companies you can expect to be involved in Linux who've built their entire business around Linux, or at least around Unix. Companies like Red Hat, Oracle, SUSE, Canonical, and a bunch of others. Anything that they do doesn't really surprise me. And considering that even companies like Microsoft are involved in Linux nowadays, it takes a lot to surprise me when I find out a company I didn't know was working on Linux just is. And apparently, isn't new to working on Linux, they've been doing so for a while. However, that doesn't mean that I can't be surprised. So you may know about this thing called FOSSdom. It's a big FOSS convention. People talk about Linux, they talk about BSD, they talk about programming. Very important thing that happens every single year, or at least should be happening every single year. Maybe sometimes they take a year off. There was a talk held by developers known as Grayson and Chris. Two engineers from a company known as Geico. Not some weird, random European organization that happens to have a similar name, happens to be some sort of similar-sounding acronym. No. We are talking about the American insurance company with a lizard logo. That Geico. These engineers at Geico are part of a team called OS and Language Runtimes, which, as of the planning of this video, I didn't know that department existed. I didn't know that Geico did any Linux work. I don't know what an insurance company does outside of handling insurance claims. Apparently, they do other things. Apparently, sometimes they might develop the Linux kernel. Sure, I guess. If you told me an insurance company ran an ice cream shop on the side, I don't know, I'd probably buy it. As I said, I don't know what else they do besides dealing with insurance. Anyway, the talk they held was called Tux Tape, a kernel live patching solution. Now, kernel live patching, as you might expect, is when you patch a live running kernel. Wow. Who would have ever expected? Normally, when you do a kernel update, you need to reboot your system. If you haven't rebooted, your kernel has not been updated. It might have a newer package, but you are not running a newer version of the kernel. This is what you're most likely going to be doing on a desktop system. However, for the enterprise cases, servers, things like that, where downtime in the immediate is kind of unacceptable, live patching attempts to solve that issue, or at least mitigate that problem. So when you live patch a kernel, it's not exactly the same as patching a kernel, which can then be rebooted. Basically, what is done is you're taking a point in the kernel where there is a problematic function and then redirecting that function out to a separate bit of code. There are some limitations here. It can't fix everything, and it is supposed to be a temporary solution. At some point, the system should be rebooted to a proper updated kernel. Also, you should just reboot the system to ensure the system actually can be turned back on. There is this long-running meme about, oh, system uptime, I have 12 years of uptime on my system. Do you know what happens if you turn it off? Well, you better find out before it happens. Live patching is not meant to be a long-term solution, but in the short term, it can be very useful on certain systems. Now, as you probably expect from the fact that the term exists, there are already tools that exist to do this in the kernel. But from their experience, nothing actually meets the needs they have. For example, none of the paid solutions meet their needs. When it comes to the open source solutions, they don't feel like there is a good open source solution. Gen 2 eLife patch is no longer active, last being updated about 6 years ago, and Debian's Linux Life patching is still in its infancy. Now with this Tux Tape tool, currently it is not open source, but as it progresses further and further, it will be open source. This is the way a lot of people like to do things. They don't start things open source initially. They want to get it to a point where, you know, it's actually ready to look at. Because what often happens is somebody like me, or maybe Pharonix, or somebody else, finds the tool, talks about the tool in a state where it's very clearly not ready, and it gives it a sort of negative impression. So it makes complete sense to do things privately, until you at least have, like, you know, a version 0.1 or a version 1 that's ready for people to see. Now, it's not explicitly mentioned at this point in the talk, but there are also things like Red Hat's kpatch, which is upstream in the kernel, Oracle's ksplice, and SUSE's kgraft. These are the most well-known solutions that currently exist. As I was saying before about how kernel patching works, here is a diagram of the kpatch model. As I said, basically redirects the call into the properly patched bit of code. But when we're dealing with kernel life patching, it can't just take any patch out there. There's certain requirements it needs to meet. For example, it cannot directly modify statically allocated data, at least without a workaround. And this project as it stands is a very early work in progress, so it's gonna be a while till anyone, you know, really sees it out there in the wild. But as it stands, there are a couple of goals they currently have. Firstly, the generation of raw patches, basically the git diff of exactly where the problem is and the solution to that problem. Basically looking at the Linux CNA, the CVE numbering authority, and then working out where things link together. Currently though, they're not taking those raw patches and then converting them into a form compatible with live patching. That is something that is a more manual process. Something I think is really cool, even outside of the whole live patching thing, is seeing which CVEs actually affect your kernel build. Because when there is a security issue in the kernel, which is basically anything that could go wrong in the kernel, there is a CVE attached to it. There's a lot of CVEs generated for Linux, and it can be hard to tell what ones affect your build, whether you have a file that's even going to be involved in that. Like, for example, if you have an NVIDIA system, nothing related to AMD is gonna be part of your kernel build. Like, that's not gonna affect your system. And there are so many other bugs like that, where even though it's technically a bug in the kernel, it's a code path you're never going to see on your system. They'll also be exploring what the maintenance workflow is actually like for the devs making these patches. What is the best approach to take here? And like a lot of the stuff happening in the FOSS world right now, of course, exploring doing things in Rust. Now, live patching is not something the regular Linux user is ever going to be looking at. And honestly, I could just never talk about live patching and nothing in your life would change. But considering this is something coming from Geico, that alone by itself was too funny to just not at least talk about a little. But what do you think? Let me know your thoughts down below. Did you know Geico did Linux work? If you did, how did you know that? Anyway, down below. So, if you really liked the video and you want to become one of these amazing people over here, check out my Patreon, subscribe to Libero Pay, linked in the description down below. That's gonna be it for me, and I'm a lizard. What is this?